WF Howes presents an unabridged recording of From Mohair Suits to Kinky Boots by Geoff Deane, narrated by Geoff Deane. For the saucepan lids, Woody, Nelly and Otis, and my friends, Jackie and Bruno. Autobiographies are for people who have led truly extraordinary lives, although so famous you don't notice they haven't led truly extraordinary lives. I'm neither. So what we have here is a collection of musings and recollections that I hope will entertain. If anything you read should move you or provoke serious thought, I'm humbled. But all I really care about is the laughs. Straight out of Hackney. In late 1969, we moved away from the council flats in Amherst Road, Hackney, a place I loved and the only home I had ever known. My dad had got a better job, which allowed my parents to take out their first mortgage. The new flat in leafy North Chingford had cost a princely sum of £5,400. I can still recall the family's trepidation at taking on such a fearful financial responsibility. In truth, it was a good time to move. Most of the people we knew were being rehoused in newly built tower blocks, ominous-looking monoliths that cast their brutalist shadow over the neighbourhood. This simple switch from living horizontally to vertically would kill a community's life force at the stroke of some authority planner's biro. Mums who had once stood out on balconies having a natter with her next door while they kept an eye on the kids playing below would now not see their neighbours from 1 month to the next. When they did, it was usually in a lift that stank of piss. But hey, the flats had central heating, yay. So I was pleased to swerve them, but broken-hearted about leaving the flats. Living there would always remain amongst my happiest memories. There was so much I would miss about them, not least my family, most of whom seemed to reside there. Beneath us was my Uncle Sid and his four boys. Known locally as Joe Cunt, Sid was a taxi driver and street fighter who also minded the door at the notorious Regency Club just down the road. Being a somewhat chippy geezer, my uncle always thought people were taking liberties with him. On such occasions, he was often heard to utter the phrase, "Do I look like my name's Joe Cunt?" At some point, everyone in the community decided the answer to that was a resounding yes, and the nickname stuck. Even his missus, my Auntie Millie, called him Joe Cunt. Opposite us was my Auntie Bessie, who weighed in at a healthy 34 stone. She was apparently a good-looking woman in her day, though no one could tell me exactly when that day was. Her husband was a bald little bloke named Will, whom she always affectionately referred to as Shithouse. The only thing these two had in common was that his weight went into hers exactly four times. A few doors along the balcony from us lived my nan and granddad. My nan's sister, Auntie Ginny, also lived with them. Today we would say that she had special needs. In those days, descriptions were less generous. Ginny used to keep budgies that spoke in a chirpy imitation of her own rather strange voice. She once said to me, "I had three budgies, but they both died." If you think my family was some kind of oddball anomaly, then think again. That block of flats was like the Twin Peaks of East London. There was one chap who rejoiced in the handle "Old Bollock Neck." Okay, rejoice may be pushing it. I expect he hated said moniker. But that is what everyone called him either way. If you have a spare moment or two, I'd like to tell you about him, because if I don't, no one else will. His given name was Reuben. He must have had a second name, but I never stumbled across it. I only knew he was Reuben because my mum, a woman of some natural refinement, refused to say the word bollock. She said a lot of other things, but a bollock never crossed her lips. Now, Reuben was an unusual-looking chap, to be sure. Rotund and walking with a cane, he boasted the kind of bright scarlet complexion I now know indicates high blood pressure. Back then, I just thought his head was about to explode. On top of that was a shiny bald pate on which sat three different-sized growths in close proximity to one another. From an aerial view, his dome must have resembled a small map of the Galapagos Islands. Such bumps on the nut were not uncommon back in the day. My dad's sister Eva had a couple we used to see every Christmas when we dropped off the presents. Having an albeit thinnish head of hair in which to conceal them gave Auntie Eva the drop on Reuben. but us kids would stay amused for hours trying to catch the occasional glimpse of one through a wispy backcomb bonnet. Good times. Now, any or all of these physical attributes might have warranted the issuing of a nickname, but none were responsible for Rubin's. That, you may not be surprised to learn, was down to a goiter on his neck. And what a goiter it was. It hung down on his shirt collar like a honeydew melon ensconced in a double XL scrotal sack. The bastard thing was enormous. Every time Rubin walked through the flat, some budding Cockney Oscar Wilde would shout, "Oi, bollock neck!" in his general direction. For years, his response would be to raise his cane in anger. Later, like a stone floor worn down by the passage of time, the same gesture became more of a tired acknowledgement. Now I would never see Rubin or his bollock neck again. There were others, Ginger Sadie on the ground floor, who had the misfortune to own a front room whose outside wall was the perfect size and location to serve as goal during our not infrequent kickabouts. The endless pounding of ball against brick must have driven her insane. The game would stop as she came out screaming the odds at us, then resume again the second she walked back in. The sheer repetition of this scenario playing out was a comfort I would miss, though I doubt Ginger Sadie felt the same. And let's not forget Ruffy Bryan, the wiry teenage bully with perhaps the campus nickname in all East London. As an 11-year-old, I had grown tired of him always pushing us around and finally decided to fight back. During the set two that ensued, I bit him hard on the ear and pushed him down a flight of stairs. I became hero for a day and brought proof to the old adage about standing up to bullies. The day after that, Brian got an older mate of his to kick the crap out of me, and normal service was resumed. I never trusted an adage again from that day to this. Now it was on to pastures new, and pastures there certainly were. Despite its East London postcode, North Chingford was remarkably rural, the more so to an inner city slicker like my good self. There were fields and forests, a village green and cows that wandered freely in the streets. I used to tell my kids that the first time I set eyes on a cow, I thought it was the biggest dog I'd ever seen. This was a joke. I'd seen pictures of them in books, obviously. The main thing that struck me about Chingford was how white and English it was. I had grown up amongst Forbatoos, Jamaicans, Irish and Pakistanis. The Jamaican presence especially had been impossible to ignore. The Scar and Blue Beat blaring out from the houses on Sandringham Road, the stalls selling exotic looking fruit and veg down Ridley Road Market, the gaggles of snappily dressed rude boys hanging around street corners talking in rapid fire patois. It was a culture I took to easily, and it had quickly left its mark. Queuing up for the latest Trojan releases in Musicland on Ridley Road Market, playing them full volume on my sky blue Danset portable as I picked out my outfit for that night. The quiet thrill of being one of the few white faces in the Four Aces Club in Dalston. Chingford was just a 20-minute train ride away, but it may as well have been another planet. I also made the mistake of arriving there with a bloated sense of self-importance. While I was still very young, I was a swaded out of Hackney, one who had his new neighbours marked as yokels before he'd even met them. This misassumption was soon corrected. What they may have lacked in attention to sartorial detail, they endeavoured to make up for with an endlessly imaginative capacity for extreme violence. There was a local night spot, the Lorraine Club, where such youths would gather for a skank and a punch-up. One night, a bus ferrying would-be revellers was attacked and firebombed by a rival mob from Debden. Seriously? Who firebombs a double-decker bus on a village green? Another time, I was at a dance at the Chingford Assembly Rooms when a Wild West-style fight broke out. Amidst the mayhem, a cassocked priest appeared with raised arms and appealed for peace. It didn't work. A fat bloke called Lips picked him up and threw him off a balcony. Seaside Shuffle by Terry Dactyl and the Dinosaurs were playing at the time. I've always had an ear for detail. Being less than enthralled with this new environment, I would get the train back to Hackney most nights and hang around with my old mates. I'd then get a late train home to Chingford and make the 20-minute walk to our flat, which was on the Ridgeway near the fire station. On one such journey, while walking along Station Road, I saw three skins, all older than me, hanging around the dark and otherwise deserted street ahead. I felt like the captain of the Titanic must have on first spotting a big chunk of ice through his binoculars. I knew there was going to be trouble, as you always do on such occasions. I put my hand inside the pocket of my Harrington and clenched my keys in my fist as a makeshift weapon. Then I kept walking, closer, closer, closer. What you fucking looking at? Now, I could have said three ungainly troglodytes wearing the fashions of 6 months ago. Or even the excellent range of cycling accessories on offer in Halford's window. But discretion being the better part of valour, I elected to remain silent. It did me no good at all. They came and they came hard. I was battered senseless. Welcome to Chingford. I arrived home a bloodied mess, and my old woman immediately went into her world-famous impression of a hysterical Jewish mother. This was almost as painful as the beating. She repeatedly asserted that I must have done something to annoy them, which is a very Jewish take on a random act of violence. But in a way, she was right. I didn't look quite like them. I didn't even walk like them. Like most of my mates, I picked up a bit of a Jamaican stroll, where you push yourself up on one foot as you go. It was an arrogant strut, one that could be quite annoying on a Jamaican and a good deal more so on a 15-year-old Jewish kid. Either way, they had sensed I didn't belong, and that had been enough. My mum and dad, on the other hand, were settling nicely into their new upwardly mobile lifestyle. Away from the family, they had started to make new friends. Amongst these were our neighbours, the Joneses, who were both Welsh and school teachers. Moira, the missus, was lovely. In her early 30s, she had long brown hair and brown eyes, a fresh-faced smile, and wore tiny cotton mini-dresses. She reminded me of a TV series of the time called Take Three Girls, about a flat share in swinging London. All I can recall about Mr. Jones is that his name was R4 and he had a beard, which probably tells you as much about me as you will ever need to know. The Joneses would often be invited in for dinner, which was of itself an innovation. Dinner parties? What the fuck? The nearest we'd come to such things in Hackney was when someone brought home a tin of pie and mash and we'd all gorge ourselves senseless sat around the telly. At these soirees, it was always Moira that held court. She was bubbly and talkative and a fount of modern progressive ideas. This was all new terrain to me and I couldn't get enough of Moira or her free-spirited ideals. She always made a point of talking to me like I was an adult and asking my opinion. Probably the first grown-up to ever do so. In return for such flattering generosity, I made her the regular star of my teenage sex fantasies for years to come. I recall one time looking out of my first floor bedroom window down at the back garden. Moira lay asleep on the grass and her dress had risen up around her waist. It was the most erotic thing I'd ever seen. Though at that point in my development, it would be fair to say competition was somewhat thin on the ground. When we moved, I switched schools from Hackney Downs to Sir George Monarchs in Walthamstow. The two establishments had a lot in common. Both had delusions of grandeur rooted in their past. Both were shitholes by the time I got there. At Hackney Downs, our official school sport had been a game called Fives. It was played in something like a squash court, only with a padded glove and a hard ball. The game had been invented by students at Eton in the late 19th century. What the fuck it was doing in Hackney in the late 60s was anyone's guess. But Monarchs managed to top even that. There we had all year round swimming lessons in the icy cold school pool, lessons in which all students were compulsorily naked. Imagine it, 40-odd pallid teenagers stood trembling with cold and embarrassment, hands clasped over their bollocks before being ordered down into the freezing water. The school's official line was that it was good for the constitution. Personally, I could never see the connection between wellness and having your cock out. As if all this was not sufficient a treat, a teacher, a boss-eyed geezer named of Chatwin, would stroll around poolside with an Hampton the size of an anteater's snout slapping against his thigh as he went. Yup, he was also naked, despite never actually getting in the water himself. Try putting that in an Ofsted report and see how far it gets you. But it was at Monarchs that I would eventually start to make new friends. My recent transition from hard-working student to class wag undoubtedly helped the process along. Name me two types of chemical bond. Premium and James. Get out. My best mate was Neil Weaver. He was into the same clothes and music as me and also a Spurs supporter. We started going over White Hart Lane together and then hanging out of an evening. Neil was a star player for the school football team and had a kind of prom king gloss about him. Neither of these things were remotely true of my good self, so knocking about with him helped put me on the fast track to a new social circle. Another advantage was his sister Jackie. She of the twig the wonder kid eyes and immaculate dress sense. She and her crew of mates were as sheepskin coated goddesses, older, cute and very cool. I was in awe of them. It was Jackie who first mentioned the Tottenham Royal Dance Hall to us. In its time, the Royal had been a haunt of Teddy Boys and later Mods. Bands like The Who and the Dave Clark Five had played there. Now it was once again the place to see and be seen. Truth be told, we'd never heard of it, but we acted as though we had, then headed down there at the first opportunity. From the moment I set foot on that hallowed ground, I knew the Royal was a game changer. It was cavernous, there were disco balls, and it had plastic palm trees. Most of all, it was full of kids like us from all over London, all dressed up to the nines. I was in heaven. Years later, I would write about the Tottenham Royal in my song, Saturday Night Beneath the Plastic Palm Trees. 69 was a very fine year, was a teenage rebel who knew no fear, hanging around the flats at night, drunk on cider, out of sight. 6 months later, Barnett's grown, I got a mohair suit to call my own, button-down shirt with a windowpane check, brand new strides with a dog-tooth fleck. Growing up, I need much more. Youth club kids were such a bore. Me mate Neil said there's a place he knows where his elder sister and her mates all go. Saturday night beneath the plastic palm trees, dancing to the rhythm of the Guns of Navarone. Found my mecca near Tottenham House Station. I discovered heaven in the Seven Sisters Road. Cruise from Balham and Golders Green and loads of places I'd never been. The stroke of 10, a fight breaks out. Hear the bouncers scream and shout. Sling him out, he's wearing boots, cried a gangsters dressed in dinner suits. They black his eyes, his nose gets bent, courtesy of the management. Saturday night beneath the plastic palm trees, dancing to the rhythm of the Guns of Navarone. Found my mecca near Tottenham House Station. I discovered heaven in the Seven Sisters Road. Eddie Holman slows things down. You ask a girl to dance, but you get turned down. Maybe it's just not your day. What do you want for five bob anyway? I was cool drinking rum and black, and then felt sick on the journey back. I got soaked right through in the pouring rain, but next week I'm going back again. Saturday night beneath the plastic palm trees, dancing to the rhythm of the Guns of Navarone. Found my mecca near Tottenham House Station. I discovered heaven in the Seven Sisters Road. Seven Sisters Road was a bit of artistic license. It was further down on Tottenham High Road, but that would have made a really shit chorus. What was great about our nights out at the Royal was that my old mates from Hackney would also be there, so I'd spend my time flitting back and forth between my two groups of friends. After a while, I'd spend less time with the old crew. It was like getting back together with someone you'd met on holiday. Without that thing you'd had in common, there just wasn't much to talk about. Eventually the night came when I didn't even bother going over to say hello. I'd relocated to Chingford with my parents some 18 months before. Now finally, I'd moved. Even androgynous creatures of the night are prone to painful wardrobe injuries. The years 1971 to 1972 brought many changes, most of which were to my wardrobe. I had gone from monogram blazer Dapper Dan Suede-ed to East London's very own Spider from Mars. Neon ginger electric shock hairdo, eye makeup, bright blue Mr. Freedom Oxford bags and Anello and David girls shoes. At a strapping 6'2", I did not blend into crowds easily. By this time, I also had a regular girlfriend, whom we'll call Hazel. Hazel wasn't her real name, but the lady in question is now married to a vicar and I have no wish to cause her any embarrassment or trample over her old man's sacraments. Hazel is what we used to call a top sort. Also a former suedehead, she was now all pillbox hats, huge purple quiff, and Miss Mouse skin-tight pencil skirts. Together, we looked like we'd just left a party at Warhol's factory and were on our way to meet Brian Ferry for cocktails. But in truth, we were gutter snipes, council flat kids living at home with our parents. And as such, there was one thing we valued every bit as much as tickets to see Ziggy at the Rainbow or a day out shoplifting at Bieber. That most priceless commodity is for young couples since records began. Time alone indoors. Because in those days, working class parents barely left the house unless it was to bring back provisions. The world we aspired to was all bisexual creatures of the night taking a walk on the wild side. But in Manor House M4, I had to make do with a quick kiss goodnight on the doorstep while I tried to slip my hand inside Hazel's bra before her dad came out. And Hazel's dad always came out. Many's the time I walked home with balls the same colour as my Oxford bags. So when the lovely Hazel announced that her parents were going to visit her brother and his wife, this was the cause of some celebration. Cue Bowie Boy clicking Wedge Heels together while performing a Lindsay Kemp-inspired dance of joy in the front room. On said day, the parents did indeed exit as scheduled. I know this because I could see them through the bush I was hiding behind. I knocked on the front door and some 30 seconds after that, me and Hayes are in bed. Now, it is a strange and I think indisputable truth that whatever point two people have reached in the gamut of sexual contact, the simple sound of a key entering a lock would bring all proceedings to an immediate and crashing halt. And so it was on this occasion. Hazel's parents came back. Apparently they'd forgotten something, like her old man's well-founded lack of trust in me. I shot out of bed and, forgetting the niceties of underwear, was into my jeans in record time. But the manoeuvre did not go as planned. The meeting of an abruptly softened penis and a harsh metal zipper was never going to be a warm one with greetings exchanged. But the surge of unbridled agony that coursed through my lower region was indescribable. White light, white heat, blue murder. You remember that little metal spiky bit that used to be at the base of zips? That. I was well and truly speared. Worse still, the only position I could find any relief in was bent over double. So that was how I stayed, tears now streaming down my face. Hazel tried to help, but it was useless. Her mum got wind of the situation and proved to be an unexpected ally. First, she kept the old man at bay. Then she entered the bedroom clutching a pack of Lurpak, slightly salted as I recall, and offered a helping hand. I declined. The prospect of a 60-year-old Jewish woman basting my old chap like a miniature Christmas turkey was doing nothing for my rapidly fading dignity. I can't say who it was that eventually called for an ambulance, but I have a vivid recollection of two paramedics trying and failing to stifle laughter. "Grit your teeth and I'll give it a quick rip upwards," said one. "Like fuck you will," I replied politely. And so I was lifted onto a stretcher, sitting bolt upright, and carried out into the lift, which had people in it, of course. The ambulance ride that followed wasn't much fun either. It's amazing how aware one can become of uneven road surfaces in that position. We arrive at hospital, and I'm thankfully whisked straight through for immediate treatment. Even today, the National Health Charter ensures all A&E departments have a policy of prioritising embarrassing penis injuries. The steady stream of giggling young nurses that poke their heads around the curtain is the stuff of nightmares. But that's a prelude to the doctor who approaches, wielding a razor-sharp scalpel inches from my crotch. "Try and relax," he says. This is not so easy, considering the last time anyone went near my penis with a scalpel, a significant slice of foreskin ended up down the waste disposal. He comes in closer, closer still, and begins to cut away my jeans. I breathe a huge sigh of relief. In around a minute, I am naked from the waist down, only with a zip hanging off my knob. Without the encumbrance of the jeans, he is soon able to release my now battle-weary member. Free at last, free at last. Thank God I'm free at last. I'm left with what was then known rather unpleasantly as a black man's pinch, a distorted bubble of blackened blood under the skin. "Can I give you anything for that?" asks my saviour. "Do you have anything that alleviates the pain but keep the swelling?" I inquire. He doesn't laugh. I leave. which might be a good place to end this sorry tale. Save for one thing. I had to walk back out onto the street to get the bus home, with my ziggy haircut, no shoes, a shirt Hazel had thoughtfully draped over my shoulders, and a pair of jeans that had the crotch cut out, and no underwear. And that, my friends, really was a walk on the wild side. A man called Alf. Walthamstow Town Hall is a handsome devil of a building that I'm never less than happy to cast my minces upon. Designed and built by British architect Philip Dalton Hepworth, it's set way back from the road with clean lines constructed from white-grey Portland stone. It also boasts a beautiful fountain-cum-water feature out front. Increasingly, as the years tally up, things I'm drawn towards tend to have memories attached to them. Well done, Geoff, you're finally turning into your mother. Anyway, such is the case with the town hall. Be it sitting with my kids, cooling our feet in the water during a scorching hot summer gone by, or warming up with a glass of mulled wine from my buddy Bruno's stall during the annual Christmas market. So not just a good-looking gaff then, a happy one. Inside the town hall are the beautiful Art Deco assembly rooms. In the early 70s, I had a part-time job working as a kitchen porter for a caterer named Alf Altman. The weddings and bar mitzvahs Alf catered were usually held at the assembly rooms, so that became home turf. Remember that stupid-looking bloke with the dyed Bowie cut, loading heavy tea chests full of crockery and kitchen equipment onto a truck while you were waiting around in your finery for your carriage to take you home? That was yours truly. Those Mr. Freedom Oxford bags did not pay for themselves. Working for Alf was long, hard and frugally rewarded. A 17-hour day for a score and a roast chicken. But as I had no discernible skill set beyond an ability to turn up, I didn't much grumble. Truth be told, I enjoyed it. The people were friendly and we had a laugh. And being part of a well-drilled, if somewhat frenzied operation, was strangely satisfying. These functions were huge life events for the people hosting them, and there was a genuine desire not to let them down. At the centre of proceedings, barking out orders like Monty at El Alamein, was the always irrepressible Alf. Alf looked in his early 70s, but with the stress his chosen field inspired, he could have been 32 for all I know. He'd kick off the day by sending me out to get his cigarettes. 100 senior service. Untipped. Yikes. By 8 in the evening, he'd run out and was poncing off others. For most of the day, you wouldn't see Alf. You'd just hear his unmistakable rasp emerging from behind a dense cloud of smoke. A one-man Chernobyl in a tux that had seen better days. But Alf knew the game inside out, and what a game it was. A cycle of cooking, plating up, serving, clearing away, washing up, and then going again. Through 6 courses for around 250 to 300 people, plus canapés, champagne cocktails and a cold buffet on arrival, not to mention a bar fully stocked and manned for the endurance. Did I mention the coffee and pastries served later in the evening, just in case the 17,000 calories previously consumed had been burned up on the dance floor? Things would go wrong, sometimes disastrously so. Rock-hard sorbets, split sauces, ovens that wouldn't heat. On one occasion, a chef cracked under the pressure and did a runner mid-service. But Alf was wired into the entire event like Davros to the Dalek Empire, and a solution was always close to hand. At the end of the night, the guests having left happy, Alf would survey the now-empty ballroom, point to the tables, and bellow out his inevitable final order of the day. Fruit off, flowers off. Fuck off. And we did. Adventures in the rag trade. There seemed to be a lot of characters about when I was growing up. Maybe there still are. Or maybe there isn't sufficient breathing space for them to thrive anymore. I'm not sure. I remember my late cousin Tony, a black cabbie of the Gooner persuasion, telling me about another driver whose entire raison d'etre had been to secretly slip items of cutlery about the person of others he ran into in the course of his working day. So one might stop to exchange pleasantries, then arrive home to find a fork and a spoon secreted away in your overcoat pocket. Kept it up for a lifetime, apparently. I've always admired that kind of commitment to a cause, especially when it's a stupid one. Anyway, enough bunny. Here are a few words of one such character of my historic acquaintance. Back in the day, we're talking 1973 or thereabouts, I had a Sunday job working down Brick Lane for a legend of a geezer with the unlikeliest of handles, Sefton Cheskin. What to say about Sefton? A 4x2 in his mid to late 40s, he sported a dodgy auburn syrup worn at a rakish angle and was an inveterate spieler on a losing streak the length of the Yangtze. Sefton owned a run-down old shop that was stuffed to the rafters with piles of clothes, mostly whistles of every size, shape and colour. Little was in any semblance of order and nothing was priced. It was a smallish gaff, but of a Sunday, Sefton had some 10 or 12 youngsters like me working for him. Most of the boys were Jewish and worked during the week at esteemed West End establishments such as Cecil G and Take Six. So what attracted us all to a madhouse like Cheskin's? In short, the money and the larks. For this was a shop like no other. Well, no other I've ever happened across. The day would kick off with Sefton arriving with a tray of warm Chelsea buns fresh from Kossoff Baker's, their sweet cinnamon aroma filling the air. The chaps would stand around tucking away the pastries and drinking coffee until the first customers arrived, which rarely took long. When they came, it was usually thick and fast. But here's the thing. Sefton's clientele was almost exclusively Nigerian, usually wanting a bulk buy at a discount to take home to flog. Try to visualise it. A cramped shop full of unpriced schmutter and back-to-back Jews and Nigerians haggling over price and quantity. It was like the fucking Somme in there. And all manner of attempted trickery from both sides was par for the course. A lot of the whistles in Cheskin's were actually very good, probably retailing straight for about a ton to 120, even in those days. Others looked like they'd been knocked up by a blind Bulgarian working out the back of a hooky polyester farm. These were not worth the price of a stale Scotch egg. So if you could slip one of the latter into a purchase of a dozen of the former, you and Mr. Cheskin would be quids in, even after having had some outrageous last-minute discount beaten out of you by the punter. That was how the game worked. No rules and fuck off will I take a Gregory Peck. Ready's only, mate. I remember one time Sefton bought in a job lot of about 100 or so greatcoats, the kind of thing that was popular amongst students and hippies at the time. Nigerians, not so much. And to make matters worse, they were a 56-inch chest, every fucking last one of them. But if you could out even one, the bunts would be significant, what with Sefton Cheskin having picked them up for a price in the vicinity of Gurnisht. If you could cajole a punter into trying one on, just in from Paris, exclusive, and I can do you a deal, you still had to get around the fact that they were some 10 sizes too big. To overcome this, we would explain that being the height of contemporary fashion, the way to wear them was belted at the back. We would assist with this, folding in ruddy great swathes of excess greatcoat behind the belt in the process. Coats were sold, money was made, and many laughs were had. But the most memorable thing about working for Sefton Cheskin Esquire was the man himself. Every conversation I ever had with him, or saw him have with anyone, be it friend, employee, or punter, was littered with references and asides to Mrs. McArdle. That looks lovely on you, mister. Mrs. McArdle was in yesterday. She bought one for her Harold. He was happy, but I bet her Bert will have something to say. Oh, look, there she is now. Mrs. McArdle, gotta go, mister. The young fella will take your money. Needless to say, Mrs. McArdle didn't exist. Unless she was a distant relative of Larry Grayson's Everard. It was just Sefton's thing. How it started and why he did it, I couldn't really hazard a guess. I'd like to say people just did shit like that back then. But they didn't really. It was only him. MB. Months after writing this, I was having a chat with a latter-day mate of mine, Mark Baxter, and it turned out Bax had also come across the man Sefton. Back in 1989, the week the Berlin Wall had come down, they had run neighbouring stalls in Camden Market. As luck would have it, not too far away from an old building that was being demolished. At Sefton's bidding, Bax had decamped to said building and returned with a sack full of rubble. The two of them then proceeded to make a killing, flogging its contents to unsuspecting tourists as genuine pieces of the Berlin Wall. Back then, you see, you really could be heroes just for one day. The Million Pound Mod and My Just Desserts. It might surprise you to learn that I went to law college. It may surprise you a little less to learn that I only lasted 3 weeks. It was perhaps the greatest mismatch since Playboy model Anne Nicole Smith's honeymoon night with 89-year-old billionaire J. Howard Marshall, and definitely less fun to watch. How did I end up there? Parental pressure, mostly. Well, entirely. I'd left school with next to no qualifications, thanks to my burgeoning devotion to clothes, music, and a bit of a social. But I had managed to pick up 3 good A-levels at North East London Poly. This despite the fact that I rarely attended lectures and had spent most of my time playing poker or table football and chasing round after girls. It turns out, if you're happy to read stuff, which I always am, some of it stays in your head. Who knew? I didn't have a clue what I wanted to do in my life. Still don't, for that matter. So my folks persuaded me that if I qualified as a lawyer in the meantime, I'd always have that to fall back on. I'm pretty sure I could see the flaws in that argument even then. But my mum in full flow was like a passive-aggressive tsunami with a PhD in emotional manipulation. I had neither a viable alternative nor the energy to resist. Sitting in lectures with my ziggy haircut, 3 earrings and a baggy plastic Mac I'd picked up from Lawrence Corner surplus stores on the Euston Road, it didn't need a Pinkerton's detective to work out that I didn't fit in with the hooray of Henry's in their tragic 3-piece whistles that were my fellow students. But in truth, my fate was sealed before I even entered the building. The college at Lancaster Gate was a straight run down the central line from Redbridge, where we now lived. As I was a potless student, my mum had bought me my train pass. What I did not know was that back then such passes came with a code which signified the gender of the purchaser. These were simpler times, you understand. Today you'd need to resurrect Alan Turing to cover all those bases. So it was that on my first day at law college, I came through the station wielding a woman's train pass. The ticket inspector thought I'd half-inched it and stopped me at the gate. I tried explaining, but he wasn't having it. I was already nervous, and as the seconds ticked away, the prospect of being late made it worse. Starting to panic, I ever so gently brushed the inspector aside and walked on briskly with my head down. At which point, a do-gooder decides to intervene. "I saw that," he bellows loudly while blocking my way. "You assaulted that man. I'm a witness. Call the police. Call the police." This was just what I needed. His words were as Aladdin's hand stroking the magic lamp. And instead of a genie appearing, it was council flat Geoff, skinhead Geoff, terraces Geoff. And he was in no mood for granting wishes. "Fuck off," I counter eloquently, delivering a hefty shove for dramatic emphasis. I then bid them all a fond adieu and exit hotfoot to college. As I'm sat there trying to compose myself and not look as out of place as I feel, my lecturer enters. It's the do-gooder from the station. Our eyes meet, but do not otherwise exchange pleasantries. "I don't see this working out," I think to myself. 3 weeks later, I get up and walk out mid-lecture, never to return. Having some unexpected time to myself, I go for a stroll around Kensington to consider my future and have a gander at the many fine clothes shops in the locale. Mostly the latter, if I'm being honest. Somewhat fortuitously, these two strands run into each other, and I end up getting myself a job at the John Stephen Boutique in Kensington Church Street. I figure arriving home with a job might help break the fall when I tell my parents about the unexpected swerve in my, their, life plan. Epic fail as it transpires, but that's strictly by the by. Now, John Stephen is a name I am already familiar with and quite excited by. Known as the Million Pound Mod, he was a hugely influential figure in men's fashion in the 60s and early 70s. He made clothes for the Kinks, the Who, the Stones and the Small Faces, and his shops such as Mod Mal, Lord John and John Stephen were amongst the first to introduce a previously suspect flamboyance into the male wardrobe. A working-class gay youth from Glasgow, Stephen had come to London at the age of 18 and worked at Moss Brothers, where he learned to cut patterns and sell clothes. Finding the company a tad starchy for his taste, he jumped ship and landed a gig at Vince in Newburgh Street, an altogether different kind of establishment. Vince was the pseudonym of Bill Green, a photographer who specialised in shooting wrestlers and bodybuilders in skimpy briefs for underground men's magazines. Punters who bought the mags were apparently as taken with the underwear as their contents, this being the golden age of enormous Y-fronts, and wrote in asking where they could buy them. Bill began to moonlight as Vince, and the rest is retail history. They did a roaring trade, mainly to homosexuals and theatrical types. And if anyone can tell me the difference in the late 50s, there'll be a signed copy of this tome winging its way to you at the earliest opportunity. Somewhere between his Moss Brothers training, flogging gear to uncatered for niche markets, and being a young gay working class bloke, a coin dropped deftly in Stephen's grey matter. He opened his clothes in Beak Street in 1957 and immediately started experimenting with close-fitting silhouettes and garish fabrics never before seen in menswear. By 1966, with the cultural revolution of the swinging 60s at full pelt, Stephen had 14 boutiques in Carnaby Street alone. That he had a huge impact on how young working class men dressed in the UK and later around the world is a matter of fashion history. Come the revolution, I shall sanction a statue in his honour. There's a John Stephen yarn that I love, and although a little sketchy on detail, I shall share it anyway. After cracking away in London, Stephen opened a shop back in his hometown where he was a popular man. Glaswegians, like many working-class communities, were proud of one of their own who had done well for himself. But the city had a reputation for violent street gangs dating back to the 1800s, and in the 60s, it often resembled a war zone when it kicked off between rival factions. During one such altercation, Stephen's shop was wrecked and its stock rifled. Being from the streets himself, he eschewed the assistance of the local constabulary and instead sought out a meet with the head of the Cult and Tongs, the most ferocious of these gangs with a fearsome reputation. They came to an arrangement that ensured his shop would come under the protection of the Tongs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.